what the opponent is doing. But for me, I think Echo Fox could find an Orpa more useful if they put him towards Connector. Just based on the matches we've seen, if I'm not mistaken, I feel like they've played Train in every best of three.
Yes, I believe they have. And sometimes
and the Orpa's just been rendered...
Huh? I think sometimes it's not been their choice as well.
And the Orpa, I feel, has just been rendered not as useful as he might otherwise be. Because it keeps going to...
Maybe.
Ivy and not finding any action.
Maybe James.
It's almost like they're being avoided deliberately, I don't know.
Maybe XP3 will show that it's not maybe about Mo. But maybe about something else, James. We'll have to see.
We will see indeed. But that might be a while because Echo Fox are starting on the T side, as we can see. A slow beginning, Dan, from both sides.
I'm CLG, used to this. I'm ready for this.
CLG being patient, they're just going to bide their time and let Echo Fox play their hand. We will see where the cards fall, Dan.
I don't think the cards are really going anywhere so far, James.
Tell us more about the cards not going anywhere, Dan.
Well, the cards... There are no cards, James. There's just guns. And there is the first frag from Haze. So, I mean, it looks like CLG not getting impatient necessarily, but wondering what's going on there. And Haze will be the guy to find out. First frag made. Not much info towards Inner. In fact, I believe Haze saw that it was more or less clear after the frag. So, right now, CLG kind of feeling it out at the moment, just holding players on A. They really feel like it's going to be A, and the taps are coming in. And it's looking good. They are getting multiple kills, and ATZ and Ricks are not really able to get onto the bombsite for bomb plant properly. They are going to get shut down. CLG toying, playing with Echo Fox in that round. It looked quite easy for them. And, well, that'll be a good start for CLG. And I would say that CLG... We always look to CLG as one of the more consistent top sides from North America. So I would expect them to have... I would expect this to be a really good match for them. I would be surprised, actually, if Echo Fox were able to take them to three. That would definitely surprise me, James. I would be surprised.
Well, I mean, CLG are a team who, where they make errors, they tend to repeat them. So there are weaknesses to be exploited by the Echo Fox side. So we will have to see if Sean Gez is man enough for the challenge, Dan.
Well, the thing is that also Echo Fox are going to be a team that makes errors as well. And I would wager that CLG have more experience, James, at dealing with the errors that they make like on the fly, because they have been together much longer. Echo Fox is still a new team. They still have very few maps played, still a very small sample size for us to work with. And looks like Tarik will take one frag already. So far, so good, because the push is yet to actually arrive through the choke points. And already a man has been eliminated, neutralized. And that's good for CLG's defense, because JDM just needs to pick up two frags now. I mean, and in fact, he doesn't even need to pick up two necessarily. He does have direct support on the bomb train. So CLG have actually a very good setup to effectively use their SMGs. And there is not a helmet on Sean Gez as well. So here we go. Nice position. He's on top of the train. The spray comes in. Oh, the bullets. They are no more, James. And that's going to be two frags for the two players. This is a bomb down as well for Echo Fox. This is going much better than expected.
Yeah, well, they've got two kills. That could mark the end. A2Z is trying to be as annoying as possible. Done a good job of it. Bomb down. 2-0 to CLG. I think everyone's going to be content with the situation. We'll see if Echo Fox go for the buy. One would expect that they will. Not, because they have $3,000 there. So it will be another eco round for CLG to capitalize on, or at least try. Not much going on in these early rounds.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing too is that CLG, I think they've been one of the most stable teams from North America, you know, insofar as, you know, they have received probably the least lineup changes of any team in the space of time that
stable
you can,
rosters.
Stable rosters, yeah, you know, from what we typically see here. You know, relatively speaking for the... Because North America does have a lot of roster changes as well, and CLG are probably the most consistent. I would say up there, I don't know if you can even put Liquid up there anymore. For a while, maybe you could, but not anymore. It's a little bit weird over in the Liquid camp. And Echo Fox is just going to try to get a bomb down, but with no utility, just some deagles. In fact, actually, they're just looking for frags with those deagles, a couple kills, and they'll probably be quite satisfied. But looks like so far they've only picked up one, and XP3 has been spotted now. He's going to go down swiftly, I should think. There we go. He will be dealt with promptly. and appropriately. So now the buy will come in for Echo Fox. And will we see an AWP on XP3? I mean, he could absolutely get one with no Kevlar. And maybe he's talking to his team about it.
It's a bit early to start AWP no armor, but it seems he's happy to do that, so that they will do.
I think it's completely fine, because I think on some of the picking angles that you're up against, he should be taking such fine angles that I don't think the rifles can really punish him too much. He should be able to back up and cover, but still be able to get a shot off and maybe a frag. So I believe in XP3 in his choice. Although I would say I would believe in JDM more, because JDM at the moment looks like the best AWP in NA. In fact, he probably is the best NA.
I wouldn't say there's a lot of competition at the moment.
Yeah, he's very good.
Definitely seems to be the most consistent.
He is good.
Well, triple aggression down Ivy. Fugly yet to peek. He's going to be in for a nasty surprise. XP3 holding the angle as well. That's going to allow Sean to get the nades out. And Roker's also there for support. And indeed, Fugly's shoulder will be enough. And Roker will take him down. JDM to respond. And now Roker's going to charge onto the site. JDM has just disappeared. That's a big frag for the Echo Fox side. The CLG numbers dwindling now. Hayes and Tarek remain. 2 versus 4. Roker's heavily tagged. Went off 2 kills so far. A2Z coming in from the back. Leaving Tarek alone. 2 fast frags for him. AWP survives, though, most importantly, for XP3. And they'll move on to the next round.
Very important couple kills there at the end from Tarek, but the money's kind of weird. In fact, CLG can buy, though. I think there was almost 10k on Tarek, in fact. He was 7-for-1. So he was quite affluent, and he is going to spread the wealth amongst his teammates so that they can have a buy. And this would be a really nice round for CLG, despite being in a disadvantage to control things. And Echo Fox, if they lose this one, the double E, well, not the double E, but the force buy, and then the Eco, if they lose that. And that's where CLG could really take control of the money once again, and then get the AWPs, get a healthy economy for JDM to be AWPing, because you really want JDM on the AWP. He is massively impactful with it, if you can get it on him. Now, Echo Fox are playing a very slow beginning as usual, but there's 3 players towards Ali as they do look for the pick. However, so far they're not to get it, as it is quite passive here from CLG, perhaps afraid of being picked by an AWP, but they are crab walking James, and this could mean a lot of trouble for CLG. I think only Fugly is near, and indeed there he is with the FAMAS, and JDM as well on the bomb train, but this is going to be a hard defense.
Nicely done by Sean. Opening frag onto CLG, who are already restricted. You can see Cutler is just down to the CZ. And they're content with that frag, and they're going to move back, going to try and avoid the funnel. And they're rotating all the way to B, it seems, with 2 people trying to creep in. Indeed, Hayes saw them and is going to get a timely Molotov down, but it will do little to stave off the push. That spray will help, however. The T's moving slowly into the site now. The bomb's getting planted for default. Not safe to go for a wider plant, if you will, as Astralis would do when they can. Sean Gare's going to drop a quick Molotov down just to slow the push of the CT side. He's going to rely on his teammates because he is using as much utility as possible, but there is no support for Sean. He will go down. XP3 coming in from the top. And that was the GG Molotov that Sean threw. There are no more Molotov left.
But that's like the reverse GG Molotov right there, because that's going to delay them and they could just tap the defuse and look at the position that they were forced to take. XP3 is still up there. The nade is good, but 6 HP is remaining. There's the covering fire from Tarek and the defuse comes in just in time. I think that might be the first time, James, that I've seen a team who's playing heavily for that GG Molotov situation and almost stacking up there. And then the CT's Molotov in front of them. So then they tap the bomb and then they can't peek because the fire will burn them to death.
Nice.
That's actually quite cool. And that's actually going to save CLG. And one thing as well is that some teams, they get a little bit too overzealous in just taking the halls area, the inner, the secret, whatever you want to call it, where you can throw that Molotov from in the upper area. And they get a bit zealous, just going, get the plant, and they go straight back to that position instead of actually saying, okay, you know what, let's try to push the yard a little bit. Yep. Let's try to slow the approach to the CTs. And I think that was one of the key mistakes there, potentially from Echo Fox. But CLG, they are going to force out a force buy, or create a force buy situation for Echo Fox, and they are going to go in to the site again. Will they have better luck this time?
Yep, so fast play from the T side. Again, I'm wondering about these these times that people are deciding to bring out the grenades. Two T's left. They're both on the sides at the moment. Rix is moving up. Again, at this time, he does have the GG Molotov. Three CT, so he's left A2Z alone. Two versus one now. He really needed to land that frag onto Fugly. Defuse attempt is coming in, but indeed, it will be the GG Molotov. Cutler has no choice but to back off. Coming round the back, trying to find the frag. When will Rix hear the sounds? Not much Cutler can redo in this position. No kit either, so he has to just run for his life, and Rix expects him to go connect up, looking to pop the head, but he won't quite do it, and Cutler will just watch him die.
The thing that's unfortunate is that the teammate of Cutler, I can't remember which player it was, actually had a smoke when the Molotov was going down onto the site, I think. I'm not sure on the timing on that, whether he could have reacted, or but the other interesting thing as well is do you try to smoke the upper position, or only if chance that guy in the upper area has a Molotov, do you just drop a smoke on the bomb? Because that's going to be, in a two versus one for the T, that's actually a really stressful situation, because you can't Molotov it, and then he also, he doesn't necessarily know exactly where you're defusing from, if you're going to hold it or not.
If you smoke upper though, you might not be able to see the door to bounce the Molotov off the door as well. But also, I do wonder, there was a fast play into the B bomb site. Hazard was close to the P90. In that situation, when the T's get onto the site in numbers, they're going to try and push the yard, as you mentioned before. But Hayes chose to get a HE out, and he could have died in that situation, as the front man can't afford to take such decisions. And indeed, I don't think he managed to get the first kill with the P90 there, so sometimes it's better to just keep your gun out.
I mean, hey, they've actually created a weird spot for Echo Fox, because they picked up the first kill in the rounds, and they themselves have four sport. JDM's got an AWP now, so that's super scary. Although he is tagged a little bit, obviously he's a very good AWPer. And there are quite a few players here towards Ali. They're actually backing off now. So it looks like it's going to be a long rotation for the T's, or it's going to take at least 20 seconds before we see them actually coordinate out of these choke points into the bomb site, which means that the bomb, by the time it might have a chance to go down, that kind of sprint to that plant, they're going to have 20 seconds left. So time is an issue right now, as well as the AWP for JDM, as well as these pistoling players lurking all over the place. So Echo Fox are in a really bad spot. Look how long they're taking. There's 20 seconds left, and I already thought the bomb would be almost on the site by now, but they're very, very slow. And now we get the rotation. JDM
is weird
in the back lines from the other site, so they might be able to get the bomb down here. There's no time. That's it, it's done. It is done, and they might be able to get frags after time here. This is really, really bad. Oh, they're both gonna go down. Oh, after time, two players are gonna go down. That means no money for them. Look at XP3, look at Roka. $150, $300 respectively. XP3 cannot even afford. All he can afford is that decoy, James. That's all he can afford.
What was that?
That is fully wrecked. You've used the term fully wrecked before. That is fully wrecked, my friend.
Oh my God, I don't know.
Two players dying after time. That is ridiculous.
It's train. There's so many little corners. It's too early in the best of three to be seeing things like this, Dan.
Just generally, these atrocities.
Tarix picks up an org.
Yeah, man, if they just killed two guys off the time, I'd splash the cash as well on an orc. I'd go in, James, on the orcs.
Yeah, why not? I mean, it's nice to get the scope game on, especially on a map like Train. I like it. I like the idea of it. I've tried to use the orc recently. I find the
it Krieg, does actually suck, to be honest.
I find the Krieg has more utility than the orc does.
It's a lot better.
Yeah. The good thing is that the orc and the Krieg don't have tracers when you scope in.
Oh, really? I didn't know that, actually. Yeah. That doesn't make any sense. Like, what is the logic behind that? That's probably just a bug or something. It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I don't think anybody knows how to spray with an orb at the problem.
It's so useless. Oh, the sprays.
Yeah, nice clean up here. The funnel through Ivy is working as a funnel should.
Isn't the rate of fire on the orb like terrible, as well as the damage being terrible, as well as it taking, you can't like one shot someone either.
It has better armor damage. I don't believe you can one-shot somebody from any distance.
No, you can't.
But it has better armor penetration than the normal M4. And I want to say it does more damage through rules, but I am not 100% about that, so yep. I won't say that.
Yep.
But I will check later.
I mean, in that sense, if you are going to be wallbanging a lot, then maybe there's utility, but just grab an M4.
It's cheaper,
yeah. And it does the same damage.
I used to use it on old
same
nuke.
Same situation.
In Squeaky.
All right, well, we're going to have a smoke down the ramp here. We're going to see Haze. He might be able to spray over the top of it. And then there's a flash potentially through the smoke, and then the bomb plant attempt. Or maybe the flash, pop flash for the site. Ooh, actually, it looks like they're all going towards higher. They're going to try to drop on top of Taric. Haze is going to see everything. Oh, the spray is going to be coming in right now. Oh, that full spray. Yes. Yes, James. Yes.
You seem pleased, Dan.
Well, is that not juicy? Isn't that not juicy? Imagine if that was Getright sitting there. He's just going to... I
like P90 sprays against decos, but not when people...
It's pure joy.
Not when people are on point, the point man, and they pull out HE. That I don't like.
Indeed. Well, look, I mean, just the situation is so awful for Echo Fox because they haven't been... Because they lost two players after time, their money was so screwed. There's getting reset, and then there's losing two players after time. I don't remember the last time I saw that. That's so rare that happens, and it's incredibly... impactful for the T's. At least so many rounds. Sprays come in there. Haze picks up a frags, a lot of information, and gets some pretty nice damage onto 18Z. He's down to 39. Could be worse, could be better. And so we'll have CLG now in on the bomb site straight away. I think that's a decent incendiary to force the plant on top of this lip at the back of the train. And Sean Gez is just kind of stuck in this position. There's CTs all over the place right now. They are at numbers disadvantage. So maybe it's doable here. We've got Cutler now and JDM. JDM able to pick off one player. There's no Molotov here, but perhaps Echo Fox, rather CLG do not know that is the case. Also, it's not planted lower, below the train, and there is the smoke. So they are a little bit afraid of the Molotov and just want to stick the bomb. Oh my God. Oh, that would have been great. If he would have pulled that off, that would have been so trolley. I would have loved it. But in fact, it will be the round won by Echo Fox. What a relief for them as well to actually just finally get a round back when they could actually buy.
So the AWP onto both sides. Echo Fox four rounds behind. I'm still curious to see what XP3 will do on the CT side, but for now, they will continue on the T side, five rounds left, including this one. And again, we have a slow start. Echo Fox with two players over towards the IV position. And they're just holding formation. We wonder what time they're waiting for on the clock when they will start to push forward. While they bide their time holding angles, CLG will smoke and their smokes will disappear. Astralis actually always did well to keep their grenades, especially on Inferno, until late on and really mess with people. So it'll be a man down. Sean Gears just creeping through main and making it two. Very nice exploitation of the weakened CT defenses there. Fugly up top will get traded by Rixto, so he's got a 4-versus-2 situation. Things starting to speed up now for the Echo Fox side. Cutler getting one frag, but he will also be traded. So CLG are allowing Echo Fox to catch up, and they should find themselves on the eco now. The money ranging between 2 and 3K on the CT side. So let's see how far Echo Fox can catch up in this situation. XP3 with 5 kills already.
Yeah. Yeah, 7-4. It's not too horrendous, and they have taken control of things. It looked a lot worse, obviously, when two guys died after time. I mean, there was so much scope for work to be done there by CLG, but Echo Fox now fighting back, just playing that anti-eco into the yard, only losing a single player so far. And things are pretty good for them. They don't really want to lose more than three. Oh, it's looking pretty risky now. And JDM's in a 1-versus-2. He will be finished off, but that was a little bit messy, that round in the A yard. And that typically can happen in the A yard due to the fact that the further you push into the yard, the more possibility that you can get flanked from players that you missed in the chaos from the A yard. It's just there's so many little objects. There were trains all over the place. So many little spots to kind of quickly flank or reposition. So it can be pretty chaotic. But 7-5, Echo Fox on starting to get some rounds. But will it continue here? JDM.
He has no armor. and no flashbangs will be served. They will simply walk down Ivy. Now, does he leave Fugly there and rotate elsewhere? He may need to. Echo Fox just everybody's just walking everywhere. Super fast round from Echo Fox. Just creeping straight into the B bomb site. A2Z goes down for free. No answer from the T's. Roka's made his way onto the site and he will start to plant the bomb with XP3 emerging from lower and a teammate on upper. So that's a really fast plant and a really fast flank coming in from Fugly around the back. There is a man advantage though for the T side. Soon evened up. JDM coming in from the other side of B. So we have three GG Molotovs on the T side. But again, the flank is coming in from Fugly, but his teammates are falling around him. He needs to get there. Well, it's too late now. JDM, last man standing. Again, he has no armor, so what can he really do versus three players? He will simply fall to the hail of bullets from the in-game leader.
That ended up, I think, inadvertently being a very sick counter strategy from Echo Fox. Because if you consider like the way that the dice rolled in that round where CLG said, okay, let's play aggressive on Ali. And Echo Fox said, okay, let's just walk straight into B. So that means for CLG, they got really unlucky because in that dice roll, they're playing a round where they are going to be in positions that are the furthest away from for the rotation. So they'll never get there in time. Haze did actually do quite a good job staying alive and trying to do damage and keep the retake potential alive for his team. But there's just so much of an ask that you can't blame Haze. I think Haze played it very well. But yeah, they just push Ali like that and you're going to get wrecked if that round gets played. And I think that was just a strategy loss right there. And that can just happen. Auto win by Echo Fox's choice is another way to put it. And look at this Quasi coming out from CLG. They've lost, how many rounds in a row have they lost now? It must be quite a few, yeah. Four rounds in a row they've lost. So the Quasi buy comes in. Cutler invested a lot. I think it was Cutler. He invested a lot there. I think someone's down to $1,300.
He is, yeah. I like how... Oh, nice. Can you finish it up? Rick's going to get straight out of there. Eagle follow-up. Good communication by the two teammates. He's going to charge straight up there, pick up an AK as well. I was going to say, I like how Echo Fox has been changing up the pace. A2Z has no idea that somebody's behind Electric. Nobody checking it from main. And he's going to shoot XP3 straight in the face while he tries to cover his back. He's going to leave Sean Gears alone with 25 seconds to find two more players. Gets a little bit tagged. And Tarek just turns around at the wrong time. Timing is everything. And it ended up turning Tarek into nothing. Sean Gears can't reload before Hayes takes him down from the back. An expensive round for both sides. That team kill pivotal because his teammate could have saved the situation. The player behind Electric Box. His mere presence was enough for players to turn against each other, Dan.
A really weird round. Really, really weird round, to be honest.
It was a good shot, though.
Oh, yeah, but just a Quasi by turning out to be, allow them to be victorious. It's just a really nice result for CLG to pick up because they lost all their momentum. And now we might have one of those Ali rounds again from Echo Fox. And JDM's back on the AWP. Is he playing Ali? No, it's Fugly again. JDM's kind of support there. He's playing more into the yard. But if Fugly gets some info, if he has a hard time there, JDM can turn around. But the problem is if JDM turns around and players come through team main or pop dog, then they can push onto the yard and then just gun down JDM. So that is the fragility of playing outside, is that if you have to rely on your teammates to be able to deal with certain situations, otherwise you just can't look everywhere. You have to just trust them. So
I do like the more mobile AWP though. Again, Mo was stuck being static towards Ivy on his CT side, but JDM has options available to him. Tarek and JDM going to get off to a good start here. Nice start onto XP3. Sees Roka close. Roka goes down as well. 5 versus 1. No damage done for the team side yet. Rix gets one, but could be traded. And it gets tagged a little bit, and he's moving quickly. He has the bomb in his control, but he has many CTs focusing in on his direction. There's nobody in B at the moment for CLG. Are they going to start to rotate a player over there? This is not going to be what Rix is expecting. He's going to be sure that someone's hiding on the B site, and his hesitation will allow the rotation to come in. So Hayes moving up to the upper area. Rix can try and plant the bomb, though, on his side of the train. He can plant it, well, not where he's standing right there. Oh, yes, he can, actually. The lines betray me. Down the bomb goes. He pays up top, Hayes goes down. How many 1v1s can Rix get now? As he tries to defend the bomb, this is the last round, so he's got nothing to lose here. He's got to go all in.
Yeah, The round of victory would be made by an ace here for Rix, which would be quite something. And there's three players looking to make the peaks here. Another one versus one. Rix finds another one. The headshot coming into play. Now JDM has to clutch it. Rix looks like he's good for this. And he's going to spot the head and send JDM straight off the top of the train for the ace. Rix is going to get it done. What a ridiculous result there. Sneaking into B, the money plant. And Rix essentially got 5-1 versus ones, I think, and won all of them, James. Great, great game sense. And we are going to see that 8-7. And if you look at the start, if you look at the fact that we see Echo Fox get reset, and then, they win a round after losing three in a row. The CTs win a round. And then that insane situation where two guys die after time into the reset.
That round was I don't know what that round was.
One of them had $150 and the other one had $300.
That's pretty terrible.
That is poverty right there.
Yeah, it is. Nice ace by Rixto. Again, all the CTs splitting up to try and cover as much as possible, but then they lose their numbers advantage. On a map like Train especially, that's going to give the Rix loads of opportunities to get the 1v1s and avoid being traded, which is the inherent advantage the CTs have in that situation. And there we go. They basically gave him best case scenario to clutch the round, and he did.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's great to see that he stepped up in that way once given the opportunity. It's very encouraging. And again, I'm just I really don't know how the rest of the map will play out. I mean, you would expect CLG that they would be a team that would be in a position to run some good T rounds on Train. I think CLG, this is a map where they are quite comfortable typically. So I'm expecting to see good things here from them. I don't think that ace there is going to shake them too much. Sometimes you just got to give credit, where it's due. Rix played that really well. And hey, it's time for a new half. It's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new round in Counter-Strike. Pistols. Molotov on Fugly. That is quite indicative, isn't it, of that, that they want to put the bomb down on B, to be honest. And keep Fugly in the upper area. He can smoke down and just stay upper. And then throw this Molotov later and just try to watch for flanks. That is basically Fugly's job in this round, from what I can imagine.
I do wonder, you see Sean Guest has a kit. I do wonder if the guy carrying the kit should just carry a smoke as well in this situation. Because I feel like the GG Molotov strat is...
Well, I think it's
partly a crutch for T sides, because I think it's a bit basic and it should be counterable.
Well, James, he went into the Book of Bardolph and bought a P250 and dropped it to XP3, so he's the P250 raid boss.
Ah, well.
With his kit.
Let's see. I like this. Let's see what XP. Well, I mean, but XP3 is on the CT side, so why does he? Just go for the headshots. It's the T side that need a P250.
I agree with you, James. So I agree with you completely.
He's reading the book upside down, Dan.
Yeah. And they get the plant. I mean, it's a bit of a mess everywhere else on the map, but they do get the plant. And Fugly has used his molly already. So this might get a little bit weird. We'll have to see what happens here now as the headshots come in. And JDM, he is going to be the equalizer. Able to pick up two kills, but Roka with a nice one there. Fugly's on one HP, no Kevlar. Anything would take him down right now. If you just look at him the wrong way, he is going to fall flat on his face and die. And there's Roka, gets the headshot even, overkill. And the defuse comes in. He's got plenty of time. Lots of time.
There we go. So I think with a Glock or a USP, if somebody has Kevlar and you're shooting them in the chest, it's going to require maybe more than 6 bullets to kill them, which would be why he wants the P250. But again, I mean, aim for the head. Especially, we've seen great play with pistols from players, and you've got the USPSs. So, and yeah, I think the P250 is the same amount of bullets. So if you're going to buy a pistol, although if he buys the 5.7, then he can't buy the fuse kit, so.
Yeah,
there you go, the decisions to make.
I prefer the grenade as well. I think the PT50 actually is worse, because at the long ranges, the USP is actually better, I think.
Yeah, the range, the one shot range is almost double for the USPS than it is for the. It's like 1.575 for the USPS, and for the P250 at somewhere around 800.
Well, anti-eco time ends in T main. We will see the CTs playing crossfire with some SMGs. Although, sometimes people abandon the crossfire a little bit. They like try to wide peek too much because they're greedy, James. They want to get the frags. They don't want to let their teammate get the frags. But anyway, that's a point for another time, a gripe for another moment. Now, here comes the push into XP3. The spray comes in, and he uses the crouch very well to dodge some of the shots there. He calls for his teammates, of which he has many to help him on the train yard. And in fact, XP3 played that incredibly smart. He didn't say, I'm going to stand here and frag and try and frag until I die. He just said, well, you know what? How about nobody in my team dies and all of them die and I just don't get the frags? And that's a good decision, James, because that means that they make more money. He's a smart player, perhaps. 9-8, and Echo Fox will take the lead, but CLG have the AWP. We'll see JDM running the AWP here with a double flashbang. Zero Kevlar, he is running in naked.
The good old double flashbang, let's go. Ooh, JDM off to a great start. A2Z sent packing here. The Mag 7 coming in there for Sean Gez, but he's going to get instantly traded. JDM with two frags, did very well for his team. 2 versus 2 now. And CLG have severely reduced the numbers of the CT side. There goes Rix leaving XP3 alone with the FAMAS. Versus 2. Bomb is being planted while Cutler's teammate does his best to cover the spray down from XP3. He's still got 14 bullets, so he doesn't necessarily need to reload in this situation. That should be enough to get the frag if he can find Cutler, who is probably not going to peek until he sees a defuse come in. That smoke will send him, well, there is a kit there, actually. Oh, XP3 played it well, but Cutler's just too fast on the trigger finger. Saves the round for his team, saves the AWP for JDM Captain Cadillac himself here in the flesh.
Those nice, man.
I had Shadow Daggers. I did not like them.
They don't look appealing
to
me.
I like the big knives. I've got the Bowie. 9-9, pair of nines. Now, I don't know what the nickname is, Dan, in poker. I think I've baited you too many times for you to say it this time, but the smile on your face says you probably would have said it at some point if I just stared at you for a while.
No, I just like the fact that you're triggered. You triggered yourself by doing it, and then you do it. So you're just like sitting there triggering yourself. I like it.
So Echo Fox are just trying to walk everywhere. They're trying to walk into main, which I find curious because how often are you going to find nobody in main on the T side? I think that's quite the risk, which it's fine to take risks sometimes, but I don't know if their economy is in the right place to be making that kind of play at the moment. XP3 getting taken down by JDM. We've got trades all over the place. We're somehow down to a 2 versus 1. Roko with $100 in the bank needs to clutch this for his team. Otherwise, they are in trouble. He is unable to do so. And let's have a look at the CT economy going forward into the next round. So that's my issue with just walking into main. It's not like they can buy the next round if they take risks like that. If they had their economy secured and they want to take some risks and try and, you know, crush the T's, then fair enough. But you make a mistake like that, well, a mistake. If you choose the wrong time to do it and you get punished, then fair enough. But then if the cards come tumbling down and you lose the round, you find yourself in an eco, CLG could start running away with the first game of this best of three.
Yeah, absolutely. By the way, I do find it funny that you automatically brought up the 9-9 thing, the, like the pairs. It means, James, I've conditioned you to think of
enjoy it,
to think of poker when there's any ever like a basically a pair, right? And that, but you know that works both ways, right? You know you're going to be playing poker, you're going to get that that pocket pair, whatever it may be, and you're going to have flashbacks. You're going to start associating it with all those times we casted NACS late into the morning together, James.
I'm so not.
You definitely are.
I'm going to be fully focused on the poker.
You're conditioned. To be fair, though, I mean, what are you going to be doing with those? You're going to be, it's a push shove anyway. Sorry, it's a push fold anyway. I don't know why I said push shove. Push fold anyway with those pocket pairs. Let's go.
If only poker was so simple, Dan.
As if you played Turbo Sit and Goes, James. That's why I played that. Anyway, it's 11-9 now. And CLG is starting to take a lead, and so is their economy. It looks quite healthy at the moment. Echo Fox, this is the moment to break it, because we're getting quite, you know, late into the first map here now, and this is where the economic lead can really start to decide a winner of that map. And But we'll get actually another save coming in from Echo Fox, in fact. So they want to go in with a real buy, a big boy's buy, and not perhaps, you know, a Famous hero there, maybe an AWP with no Kevlar or something, and a lacking of utility. They want to get it all in when it counts. And I can get behind that, especially, you know, with a player like, or with players like XP3, I think he's much more valuable with an AWP. So it should be pretty easy here for CLG to hold against this, unless they make a misstep. You can see the CT's trying to get some aggression in here, some double peaks, and actually doing some damage, quite a lot of damage. But there are still three players with rifles here for CLG. They should be okay.
Bomb is being collected. There is a minute on the clock. And Haze finds himself deep into the A site. XP3 goes down, leaving Rix with 4 HP. Dan, I have more fingers than he has points of health.
I hope so.
Bomb is moving towards the B bomb site with a teammate in connector, and we have a slow flank. So all the CLG players are isolated. However, I think they're fairly certain that the B bomb site is indeed safe for the time being. So bomb planted. We'll see if Rix can get anything done. Should see the buy coming out for CLG now as Rix gets taken down. 3-round lead for CLG. AWP onto XP3, so I'm curious to see where he's going to go with it. What he's going to do with it, where he is going to take it.
Yeah, it's all about this one. Echo Fox got the extra, an extra save in that a lot of teams, I think, may not have actually gone for, just to get this big buy. Is it worth it? XP3 is on the AWP, all the nades, all the rifles, three kits. They are swimming in equipment at the moment.
See, they put him towards connector. Why don't they put Mo there? Or maybe it's an adjustment they will make in future.
Maybe XP3 just went better. Ooh! Oh! JDM gets caught and barbecued. That is not nice.
He got the full George Foreman done.
Yeah, CLG in trouble right now. They can't get through these choke points. But that said, the frags are coming back their way, bringing things to a 3v3. Now, with over a minute left to go, CLG, I mean, everything is... The ball is well and truly in their playground, in their park.
That was really unlucky for Sean Gez, purely because it's hard to see people through the flames in this game. So he didn't realize how much he was exposing himself, and that has given CLG an edge with a minute on the clock here, and all the team are moving together. I like that. They're playing the trade game this time. Let's see. A2Z's got info for his team. Does that mean we're going to see a rotation from these two players deeper into B? I mean, in a situation, XP3 can hold up off a Roka while he focuses on lower. That's the kind of setup. We mentioned this in the previous games with Echo Fox. That's one of the values of having their AWPer around connector is that they can do this, although he's a bit paranoid about behind him. But he should be looking upper while Roka looks lower. I think that's the premium setup in this situation. Although with Roka so heavily tagged, perhaps it's better for him to look upper and try and get a weird angle behind that little box. But Roka's looking all over the place. It still works out, however. So, yeah, I really hope that we see Mo in that more dynamic position when he comes back, as opposed to standing towards Ivy being ineffective for an entire half.
Is Mo gone for a week or something? Do I recall correctly? Or
I have no idea.
This match?
I did not really look into it.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Either way, just, yeah, this match, he's not here at least. That is what we know that at least. He's not here. Anyway.
Let your powers of observation, Dan, continue to serve you well.
They are powerful.
As the saying goes.
I know. So JDM looking for the pick now. He's not had a huge amount of fortune going into his AWP-based plays for CLG so far on the T side, but that last win was a pretty awesome victory there from Roka, especially considering that CLG had the advantage in that 3-on-3. Roka almost one-man armied it with 12 HP or whatever it was that he had. And now CLG play a passive game again, just walking alley. There's two players there on the left. That's actually pretty dangerous. XPC can fade back. If they try to play for the trade, he can bait them, and then Sean Gares can just spray him down. And that could be exactly what's going to happen right now, because yeah, Cutler on the angle there, he's not going to spot much more, but they will smoke it off. So unfortunately for Sean Gares, that bait play is no longer really much of a factor, but they still might not expect a rifler to be so close there. So Sean Gares is in a great position still. And CLG, I mean, what do they do in this position? If they try to push Ali again with all the attention there, they're likely to lose another man, and it's just going to spiral out of control. So they're going to reassess the play. They're going to fall back from Ali, leave one man there, and perhaps try to split onto either the A sites, or are they just going to go straight B here? Looks like they're just going to go for the B plate, leaving a lurker towards Ali. But Echo Fox, I feel like they're ready for this. They got a good setup.
20 seconds left on the clock. We've seen the same from Echo Fox. Somehow, though, Tarek gets the frag. XP3 is starting to answer, but we've got two players on the site here. Tarek's very low health, going to start getting the bomb down. Haze comes in for a double peek, but there are many CTs encroaching on the position. Got a bit of a flank attempt here from Cutler, but is he going to get there fast enough? Doesn't have an angle for the bomb, but you would expect that Echo Fox would expect Cutler to be on upper. The hero, it's on hero defuse because the Molotov didn't make it there. Cutler's got to be careful now because he could get taken down. Must hide. So another round on the board for Echo Fox. They lost a lot though. A2Z should be able to drop a knot for XP3. Indeed he will. I like how XP3 is rotating his position towards connector, towards Ivy. Being unexpected, that's even better to have a dynamic AWP as opposed to a static one that Echo Fox have been playing on train as of late. One day I will stop going on about it. But again, XP3, well, the CTs in general will always get to connector faster than the Ts will. It's just how the spawns work. So he can make the call to his teammates that Cutler, well, one of the players, has made it through. You can see Rix is looking for that T. They know he's there. The flash is coming in as well.
Oh, that's a great flash too. Cutler is able to execute Rix up close. Stares him, looks him in the eyes first before pulling the trigger there. And that's going to be now Tarek. Moving in for the trades, picking up the gun there, M4. Ooh, he gets to snap onto ATZ too, so making life a little bit painful here for the CTs, really hurting their economy. But I don't know if he can really get too much more done here with 10 HP, and they got the bomb. They're somewhat aware of his position. Only two players left though, and somehow Tarek, errant bullet finding the head of XP3 there. Tarek sprays away, now playing on top of the train. Ooh, the nade. Oh, the nade's gonna do it. I honestly did not know if that nade was gonna touch him at all, because nades in this game, man, they're so unpredictable.
I wonder what the most forward CT spawn is in regards to connector, and if it's viable to, for example, buy an auto sniper and wallbang to the position where the Ts emerge into main itself, but not exposed to the site.
Right, right.
To see if you can just wreck people as they come into the position, roughly where Tarek is. I'm going to look at that then. I'm going to lose some new weapons.
Okay, well. It's a fast round there coming in as the T's march in towards the upper area, but it's going to be largely defended by Echo Fox, who are having quite the resurgence into map one now in the later stages. This is round 25, and it's still hard to predict who is going to be able to take this one over the line. But Tarek is going to be trying to get some damage in there potentially as he moves in the halls, the White Halls area by the toilets. Little office there, it appears to be a kettle, various apparatus, some lockers, we've got some dirty sinks. Hope that's a bottle of bleach there. And Tarek waits, looking for the first kill. Now, it's going to be really important for Tarek if he does decide to actually go for some kills, or maybe even try to win the round here if he does get a pick, to try to do it quickly, because you don't want to die after time. They've already been through that painful situation. Oh, I think he turned around! I think Tarek might have actually seen him turning around there. At least I think we saw that.
Well, I saw it, yeah.
Yeah, we saw that. So that's a little bit slow response. I was a response there from Tarek, unfortunately. But the 13-12
might depend on his resolution. If he's got black bars.
He's probably playing 4-3 or 4-3 stretched. 4-3 stretched is pretty cool, actually. But anyway, back to pistols again, CLG. They can't quite find anything really in this second half, it seems. No real string of rounds. And I have to give a lot of credit to XP3. I think XP3 has been playing quite well with the AWP. He's done just enough in a lot of these positions.
Yeah. It is definitely worth noting that he has been put in better positions than Mo has. So for any of you at home saying, oh, why do they have Mo on the team? It's not really a fair comparison considering Mo's been stuck on Ivy in all the previous matches for Echo Fox. So we'll wait and see what he can do in a superior position.
It's hard to say whose decision that is just yet because the team is still very new as well.
Yeah, that's true.
So he might just have said, I like playing that position.
Yeah.
Don't like making frags. So we have the 3 versus 1. Still subtle rail there. But it's all good. It's all good. It's just banter.
Echo Fox 2 rounds away from taking the first map of this best of 3, but CLG will have something to say about that. We've got the bye for them as well. JDM back on the big green gun. He's going to need to be a force to be reckoned with. Although Taric's up there with 27 frags so far. That said, it's not enough. They're still two rounds behind Echo Fox at the moment. Three men towards Ivy. This suggests the push, and indeed there will be somebody and in Ivy to meet them. That's Fugly, and he's been taken down straight away. But how many did he spot, and what will the response be from CLG? The pop flash is coming in from Roka, but not fast enough. And if all three were spotted, then things are going to move quickly here on this B bomb site.
Yeah, nice pop flash, but too slow. Now it's down to ATZ to try to delay the push of the T's. But that's not going to happen. ATZ will die. This is going to be tough here for the Echo Fox side here. We do have XP3 and Sean Gayers now making their way in. Sean Gayers just getting his hands dirty there, going straight amongst or into the midst of the T's. XP3 at range there, but he's got to close the distance onto the bomb as these T's otherwise will not peek him. Switching out for the M4. Luckily, it has some bullets, but he cannot get the kill. It's Cutler instead with the headshot. And it looks like CLG will keep their chances alive here, winning that round before Echo Fox get to number 15, which will allow CLG's opportunity to still win the map without potentially going to an overtime. But the money for both teams now is getting pretty horrible. So if CLG were to win this round, then they would go to 15. This is going to go down to the wire. This could very well be an overtime game. This has all the makings of an overtime game right now.
Well, how fast will this play be from CLG moving quickly towards the B-bomb site? Bit of a spray through the smoke just in case any CTs are up to any shenanigans, but they are indeed playing quite passive. And again, you can see XP3 is in connector with the AWP, which means they can concentrate the forces over towards A, the CT side, of one player playing close B, which is Roka. So Hayes is coming in lower, and Roka's completely flashed into oblivion here. And Hayes is about to make it to the site. He's got a teammate coming in upper as well, but XP3 is indeed holding that angle, taking him down, traded by JDM. Roka with a cheeky frag on the bomb planter, who has absolutely no cover. Man advantage for the CTs.
Peppering here from Roka, but that is quite a strong peppering. Two players dead, finding those headshots, finding the wall bangs, going for the white peak there, forcing Fugly to engage in the open. Bomb on his back. CLG desperately need Fugly to clutch this. They need this so badly, but they will be denied. Echo Fox now looking good for the W. Where is the cash? Where is the Mahonies? There is no money on CLG. If they had gotten the bomb down, they would have some AKs here, potentially, or they could at least have bought, I don't know, one or two, but that is not the reality. The reality is four Tech Nines and a Galil, and that is not the reality I want to be a part of, James.
Yeah, that's... It's a grim reality, Dan. Sean Gayers not top fragging for the team. This is a bit of a surprise, but Roka is a bit further away from B. I like it, but he's only got one frag. And the bomb is sure to be planted here. Full rotation coming in for the CTs. We have JDM going deep for the flank, actually, into connect, but is he going to get there fast enough? More trades coming in. Nice tap there by A2Z, two frags for him. He needs help from his teammates because he's got 7 HP, and that flank is here now in connector, but taken down immediately by Ricks. Leaving Hayes alone. Hayes is dead, and the map is theirs. Theirs as in Echo Fox's dad.
Indeed. So, Echo Fox, you know, stealing away this map. And the funny thing is that, you know, you said, okay, they're on train a lot. Obviously, they like to play train, otherwise we wouldn't have seen it so much in every single one of their SO3s. But also, the way that it started looked like CLG, it had CLG written all over it. They had the opportunity to get a crazy CT start, something in the, you know, in the excess of 10 rounds, something, you know, 10 to 12 rounds, I think, looked quite viable. But as soon as Echo Fox were able to recover from getting reset twice and losing two guys after time, they prevented that. And it was it like a 9-6 in the end or something?
Along those lines.
I think that, yeah. So, I mean, that's a great comeback from Echo Fox. I think XP3, again, you know, with the positions he was playing, he did a great job. He didn't, like, XP3 didn't do anything crazy or special. We didn't see any, like, insane JDM type 1v4s or something like that. But what he did do was his job. And he got the kills he needed to get in most cases.
And he was in a much more effective position for Echo Fox from what we've seen of them already on train. Yeah, I mean, I was particularly focusing on their CT side because we've seen so much train and we've seen how they've had the AWP towards Ivy and no kills have come through because it could have been used better in a more dynamic position where, you know, it doesn't have to be covering Ivy because Ivy's a long channel, as we just saw from XP3, who did rotate his position a bit as well. And again, the dynamic play there, helping Roka by covering upper while Roka holds lower. There's so much more use for the AWP in that position than how they've been playing it. So there's an adjustment there from Echo Fox and it's paid off. They've taken the first map. The second map will be Mirage, which is coming up shortly after a break. We will see you back here for map two in just a few short minutes.